quer gostar?
É?
Ok, hey. For those who don't know, that they don't know me. Edge, what? Ah, I'm studying here.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Thank you very much.
So I don't have to move from here. Okay. All right, I'm a local guy here from TCU, and I will speak most for strong field effects on atomic systems. And the overview of my talk will be some basics on atoms and molecules, atoms and fields, and their interaction, and some general things about laser sources, laser the status of laser matter interactions theories. And I will give some example about the driven two-level system for helium double ionization, and then another example about neon for just eight states, AC stack splitting, and I explain what is all this about. Okay, about atom field interaction in observables, current status of quantum theory, I will mainly speak about quantum aspects of all these laser matter interactions. So, you know, of course, the quantum mechanics of the atom was developed 90 years ago, mainly from these guys there, Planck, Einstein, and all of that. And then we had the quantum theory about the electromagnetic field 60 years ago. Dirac again contributed to this, and after that we had the quantum optics, which is a quantum theory for electromagnetic field when not many photons are present, and this has been developed to quantum electronics, quantum information, and so on. Now, for any atomic system, after the end of any pulse, no matter how strong it is, a short pulse, I'll explain what is this short pulse, it is going to be ionized or excited. Provided then that we start from the initial state, at the end we will have bounds, excited bound states, and also excited continuum states, which is nothing else than the ionization of the system. Now, in this case here, when I say short pulses, I mainly mean pulses that are much shorter than spontaneous emission lifetimes, which is about 10 to minus 8 seconds in general. So the pulses that I'm speaking mainly here are about are femtosecond pulses, 10 femtosecond, 100 femtosecond, 500 femtosecond. Now, observables that we usually were we want to calculate or to measure are ionization yields, electrons energy, angular spin distribution of the electrons, and also fluorescence, which is nothing else but the scatter radiation. Now, some properties about long wavelength lasers. The most impressive one, the titanium sapphire. There are lasers at discrete frequencies, 1.75 PVs on 5Vs, and all these lasers in the near infrared based on a transition between bound states of atoms or molecules. And of course, they are coherent, very high power, and then they are amplified because of the mirror. You're putting them in a mirror cavity. Titanium sapphire now is a state of art, 800 nanometers, 1.56 EVs. Peak intensity can be 10^21 watts per centimeter square, and pulse duration 2 cycles, which means about 5 femtoseconds, really short. And of course the period is 2.6 femtoseconds for this laser. And this is a really strong pulse. Mainly, times of firing all of these visible lasers are interacting only with the valence electrons. In order to interact for the inner cell electrons, they have first to strip off all the valence electrons and then to interact with the inner cell electrons. Now, in this photon regime, somehow the valence electrons, they screen the inner cell electrons. They offer very large kinetic energy to the electrons that are ionized, called polyromotive potential, and the interactions are highly non-perturbative with this field. Therefore, perturbative methods usually fail, and one has to solve the time-dependent statistical equation directly with almost no approximations. And of course, because of the small photon energy that they have, they mainly use multi-photon absorption for polarization of atomic systems. Now, what about the free electrons laser for the short wavelength? They operate, of course, as you know, to PUV and XUV regime. Can be 100, from 100 EV up to 10 kilo EV photon energies. They are based on acceleration of relativistic free electrons. Therefore, between they produce radiation because of transition between continuum states now, and they are coherent, tunable, and of course of very high power compared for the with the synchrotron sources. Now, currently in flash, some records that they have now is 6 nanometer, about 200 dBs, peak intensity up to 10-15 watt per centimeter square, and pulse duration from 20 to 200 femtoseconds. Of course, some drawbacks that you already know, which is, of course, those constructions are not tabletop. And another drawback that is important, compared to the synchrotron sources, it is all the parts that they have fluctuations in time and in frequency. This means that short to short passes are different. Now, what are the construction currently in the US? From the after the flash, of course, US, from the 2009, they have already an X-ray laser, and I think that one it is, of course, it's a mistake. It's not 3 days ago; it's a year ago. And the other construction now that already operating are in Japan, Italy. This year, Switzerland, in 3 years from now, if they go according to the schedule. And of course, one very ambitious construction is the XFL to come possibly to 2016. And it really costs a lot of money. And of course, all the proposals here, if you see, they include the proposal to atomic physics, chemistry, biology, nanoscales, I mean, all branches of science. Now, this is a relatively well-known graph which demonstrates the brightness of the FELs compared to the synchrotron sources. Here it is the energy of the photon, and here is the brilliance. And you see there are some orders of magnitude between the synchrotron sources and the FELs. Plus, the seeded one, XFL, it is, and here is the US machine. Now, some This is a table that includes some comparison between the long wavelength and short wavelength sources, and the first row is okay. I spoke about this. The intensities, you see them, all of them, there can be very, really very strong, the FELs, as the declining of fire. And also you can see that the period for the long wavelength, it is about few femtoseconds, while for the FELs can be really, really very small, of the arcosecond scale. Now, some properties of the interaction with the neutral atomic or molecular targets. First of all, the titanium sapphire usually induces interaction with which includes many photons when it is strong, while the FELs include just few photons. The ponderomotive energy that the titanium sapphire can give to the electron that goes away from the system can be really large. It can be much, much larger than the photon frequency of the laser. The opposite is different in the case of FELs. The kinetic energy that the electron gains when it is in FEL field is much smaller than the photon energy of the FEL radiation. Which electrons are really interacting? For the long wavelength, it's only practically only the valence one, while for the FELs, it's in priority order the inner cells and then the valence cells, electrons. Therefore, the systems are ionized in the case of FEL electrons from inside to outside. The strength for the long wavelength, the interaction is mainly non-perturbative, while for FEL, although the field can be as high as to 10 to 18 watts per centimeter square, it can be treated perturbative. And this is, of course, only matters, the calculations, because makes life simpler. And here I have something that's called above threshold ionization, and I explain what is this. In general, for the long wavelength, we have strong above threshold ionization, while in FEL's case, we have very weak. What is above threshold ionization means that the electrons can absorb even more photons when they are in the continuum, when they are going away. This is usually possible in the long wavelength lasers. Of course, you can have multiple ionization of the atoms or the molecules, and there are different mechanisms depending on which wavelength you are using for the ionization. Now, theoretical approaches. Multiphoton. Remember that now we are talking about mainly for multiphoton interactions. And traditionally, lowest order perturbation theory, an infinite pulse duration is assumed in order to treat theoretically the problem of the interaction between atom and field. And another approach is, of course, to solve directly the time-dependent centric equation, where this is the wave function of the system. Here it is the field-free Hamiltonian of the system, whatever it is, hydrogen, helium, neon, or whatever molecule. And here it is the field, the interaction with the field, time-dependent potential. In the mathematical terms, it is a partial differential equation in time and space. And basic approaches is to One is to use an expansion of the time-dependent wave function in terms of of the eigenstate solutions of the system. With the those systems here are time-dependent, and they characterize the system when this is field-free. Basically, these here are the identity of the system. Or you can use a grid representation where the wave function, it is calculated at its point, the space, for every time, the second one. Now, in general, now, when you have one electron system, which means hydrogen or hydrogen-like, if you put in a laser, it's solved ab initio, and this is now no problem, no matter how intense is the interaction. When you have a system which is, for example, argon, you are using long wavelength laser, 2 × 5, for example, if you are use the single active electron approximation, which means that only one electron is interacting with the field, again, you can solve with very good results this problem, again, relatively ab initio. Now, when you go to two electron systems, which means helium, negative hydrogen, magnesium, calcium, I remind you that magnesium and calcium, it has only 2 electrons in the outer shell, while all the others, the inner cells, have very very large difference in energy, and practically they are not excited from long wave lasers. And again, the problem, it can be treated, though it is computationally demanding. And finally, if you go to any atomic system, which when you want to deal with all electrons at the same time, which of course now one should include the FELs as well, because the FELs gets electrons from the inner cells, therefore you cannot ignore now inner cell electrons, then there is a problem. And theories are underway, either perturbative theories. Remember that the FEL, the interaction with FEL radiation can be treated perturbatively now, although the intensity of the field is really high. All right, mathematically, no matter what theory you're using, or possibly in any branch of science, all approaches mathematically, they end up to these three basic mathematical operators, which is matrix vector multiplication, the x, the red here, it is the unknown, so you know this is a matrix and this is a vector. Basically, at the end, you have to solve this problem. Or you may go to a system, to algebraic equation system, which again, you know the matrix, you know the vector, and you have to solve for x. And, or, you have to diagonalize a matrix. All theories, basically the bottleneck in the calculation are those three. And computationally, one needs to find ways to efficiently solve these problems. Of course, there are sophisticated algorithms, and work is underway and in general improving. And of course, in order to solve this, one can go to multi-core CPUs, supercomputing platforms, and rather recently one also used the power of the GPU cards, the graphics card, with great success in this direction. Now, let me explain now what happens when you have a strong field and you start from the initial state of a system. This is the initial state. Assume that this is helium or hydrogen. Then you absorb a photon because you see your because your field is really strong. Then you can have you can absorb one photon more, another one, and so on, until the system gets ionized. Usually, what happens is that, this is the Eakin state of the system, and this is also, all these are the Eakin states of the system. When the system goes here, it will stay for a little while. If the field is not that strong, this means that during this time that will go down again, there is no photon to absorb further. But if the field is strong, there are many photons around there, and before the system decays again back, then absorbs one photon more and so on, depending on the intensity of the field. Now, of course, these states here are continuum states of the system. This means that an electron goes away. But as the electron goes away, it can absorb even further photons. And this is represented by absorptions in this region. Another channel that of this interaction can be, of course, that the system absorbs photons and then decays back again in the ground state. And this is nothing else than the harmonic generation, and depending how strong is the field, where it was the system in the final state here, it decays down, it can produce a large photon, a higher harmonic photon. This interaction can also be somehow the ionization yield of this can be calculated if one uses perturbation theory by two factors, by knowing the intensity of the field, and if the absorption of the photons is n, then you have the power of this field n times an atomic parameter which is called cross-generalized cross-section, and this formula here is nothing else than the generalization of the known Fermi-Gordan rule in the case of multiphoton absorption. The ADI, for example, if the system helium here in this case absorbs many photons, and if you look the energies, you detect detect electrons as they are going out, and you measure their energies, then you will see some peaks in the spectrum. Here it is the electron energy that you detect one detects, and here is the probability to find the electron in that specific energy. And that peaks, they have the separation between these two peaks is equal to the photon energy here. And of course, so it is nothing else that it is that it does say that the electron absorbs photons on the way out from the system. This is what is called above threshold ionization, because it is ionization above threshold from here. Now, what if you want to increase even further the field? Then you can ionize not only one electron, you can ionize two electrons in the case of helium. And what is here? Here it is the intensity of the laser, while here it is the probability, the yield of the ionization. That curve here, it is the helium plus, how many ions at a given intensity one can find. And while that curve here it is how many double ionized ions can find. And you really see that increasing the intensity, then one it appears that you can also have double ionized signal. Now, I will not explain here the details of how this, why this curve here is this like this, and simply because it is not the main interest of this talk about the times of fire. And now I will turn to some discussion about doing fissions with the free electron lasers. I will not speak about high harmonic generation, fields that coming from high harmonic generation, they have different properties from the FEL here. All right. Again, what are the properties that you have? Inner cell ionization, you can have a molecular study of molecular dynamics, cluster experiments. The interaction can be nonlinear. And you can also have some multiphoton ionization, just few, not many, because of the short wavelength. And you can also have experiments with time resolved for more like photo fragmentation. And of course, you can have HUVIR experiments, pump-prom schemes. And the first experiments so far were in helium, neon, argon. And they were looking about ionization yields and some photoelectron spectroscopy. Now, currently are a bit more advanced, more sophisticated. And of course, you can also two color experiments, again with flux and the times of fire. Now, some difference about compared with the long wavelength lasers. Multiply ionization mechanism is quite different than in the case of the ionization with two times of fire. We can also have the case of OZ transitions. In this case, simply because when you ionize an electron from the inner cell, then there is a hole there, and then the outermost electrons can go and fill this hole. This is basically the sense of those transition. And now the question is what approximation, if one wants to deal with this problem, are valid. And what, of course, are the interesting observer quantities. And now theoretical groups, of course, have turned their interest in this type of problems. Now let me turn and give an example about what a strong field can do in driven two-level system with damping. Assume that we have a two-level system. The scheme is the following. I have the state 1, the state 2. I have a FEL laser. That difference here, it is omega naught. This is the energy E2. And this is E1. And here it is my electric field. The photon, the electric field interacts with this atom. The atom, assuming, of course, it has many states, but this is the a condition which we have a resonance condition. The photon frequency of the field it is very close to the energy difference between these two states. And of course, if we want to be a bit more realistic, we have also a spontaneity gate, say gamma, from the upper state to the ground state. This is the scheme. And so the lower state, it is number at 1, the upper state 2. We have the spontaneous emission. We have a time-dependent field. And now what is the problem that we want to somehow model? As soon as you have a gas with this atomic atomic system with these energy levels, and then you sign it with FEL. The question is, as the radiation goes through this gas, what is the attenuation and what happens in the atomic system, the attenuation of the field. And of course, the field, because it interacts with the atom, it can excite the system and de-excite and so on. Now, the time-dependent wave function, of course, in this simplified system, it will be a linear combination of the eigenstate of the system, phi 1, phi 2. This is assuming that is known. And what I want to find is that the time evolution of these time-dependent coefficients. If I know the psi t here, I know everything. And this is my main concern. Now, of course, one should use the time-dependent Schrödinger equation in this case. And again, I repeat, this is the Hamiltonian for the field-free atomic system. And this is the interaction, represented interaction with the field. Now, the attenuation, I have to make the following. The attenuation, a following statement without proof, but please believe me that the attenuation of the radiation, it is related with the polarization in this gas of the atomic, of the atoms here. While this polarization here, it is the matrix element of the position operator X. And this psi t here, it is nothing else than the time-dependent wave function, which it's equal to this expression here. N is the number of atoms in the gas, while V is the volume. Therefore, this is the macroscopic quantity. We assume a gas that is not very dense. It turns out that if I know omega naught, which omega naught, I remind you, it is the difference between the two eigenstates, and if I find C1, C2, then I can find polarization, and I remind you, polarization, it is related with the attenuation of the radiation, which is, of course, it is related with susceptibility or refraction index of the system. Essentially, it is I'm looking to model the susceptibility of the system in strong fields. Now, here. All right. The wave. What we know for the system under the field is its wave function, psi t. Now, if I solve the problem without the field, then I can find the eigenstates phi 1 and phi 2. And these are time independent. Those are known functions, provided that I have solved the problem. And usually it happens. Now, C1 and C2 are coefficients time dependent which their dependence is given from this equation here, the Seligman one. This means that if I know the time dependence of C1, FC2, I know everything. This is what quantum mechanics can provide me. Psi t. Okay, therefore, the polarization of, if you want, the fraction interest, linear sensibility, it depends on these two coefficients here. C1 star, C1 is times C2. I remind you that the coefficients here in general are couplers. Okay?
And what is this x? Position of what? This x?
This is the position of the electron. You have here, you have an electron. Assume that you can think about the red R. You can think of hydrogen, because you are in the field. This electron has a charge, it goes up and down. So the position, this is the position, represents the position of the electron. And the electron can go, if you want, from one S state to 2P. If it happens that your field has 10.2 eV, for example, photon energy. So it represents the position of the electron. And this, the electron now, because it is in the field, makes an oscillation. And this is the dipole that you have here, represents that one. Of course, when you have a dipole, this radiates. But this radiation is different than the one that's coming. It can be the same, can, of course, the excited produce and inducing radiation, but it also can be different. When it's different, there is a scatter radiation which goes away from the external source. And this is represented for the polarization. There is some detailed formula that one can find, but okay. But believe me that this C1, C2 here, it really represents the quantum mechanical information about the susceptibility, the response of the system on the electric field. And I saw that that response can depend on the intensity of the field. Okay? When, in general, you will see that when the field is weak, then the polarization here, it is linear to the electric field. But this is not true when the field is strong. All right. Yes, of course.
Why only C1 and C2? I think, are you trying to use the expansion theory in here? Is it for
simple? What test could play a role here?
Is it to make it simple that you are reading about the two state functions, phi1 and phi2, minus phi square?
Why the other, not the others?
Yes.
Yes, of course. I mean, of course, any atomic system, any system has many, many states. But now we're talking the case of a resonant interaction. Therefore, the dominant interaction, if you have a field, again, if you have, assume that you have the 1s to p of hydrogen transition. And if you send them a radiation of 10.2 eV, then the dominant interaction will be between 1s and 2p. All the other states are far away, are off-resonant, and therefore there will still be some excitation that will, but it will be much, much, much less. So the majority of the atoms will be excited in the 2p state of hydrogen. Do you believe this or not?
But I thought the balance one.
Again, I'm repeating, for in the hydrogen case you have just one electron. In one state, 1s, you send a radiation of 10 eVs. The first excited state is 2p, which has a difference 10.27 eVs. all the others, they are to, after that, it is 12 EVs and so on. Okay, the, every, say, 100 atoms that heat, are heated from the radiation, say the 99 of them will be excited in 2p states and not in 3p or 4p or whatever, simply because we have resonant conditions. Okay? Okay, for that's why I don't take into account other states of the system. Eh? Of course, in principle, it can be taken in a full calculation, in a real ab initio calculation. Everything is taken into account. That easily, in the resonant condition, I can see that the dominant effects are coming. Eh? So the main effects, if one study this two-level system in this case, you will see the main effects. Right? Everything else will be just a small perturbation, small correction to the main results. Now, and of course, this CC here is a complex conjugate. All right, if I define by with you the real of C1, C2, here should be star, and here as well, and V the imaginary part, and W here, that difference, and I remind you that that difference represents it's the inversion number. This is the population, represents the population of the atoms in the upper state, while this represents the population of the atoms in the ground state. The equation to be solved are first order differential equations, and this is, this will not be there, and this is rather easily solved with many methods. I can use numerical methods, or if you assume that the electric field is constant in amplitude, you can use Laplace methods or whatever for here, whatever things. Now, I skip this derivation, of course, which is also interesting, but now, what is the result? I have a steady state solutions, because the system, what happens, the system, when it's in this, when it is in the FEL interaction, it goes from here to there, it decays with the rate gamma, but of course it can also decays by de-excited because of the presence of the field. And all this information, it is here. There will be a steady state solution, which means the final state of the system when you look, you're looking after long interaction times. And one sees, remember that the important information, what we want to have here, it is the U and V here, eh? Because this is the real part, this is the imaginary part, and again I remind you that U and V give information about the polarization and the response of the system, attenuation, and so on. So, these two values here, they represent the response of the cast sample after this has been irradiated by the pulse. And what we see here, first of all, this delta here, it is the detuning. What is the detuning? The detuning is that difference. If the photon frequency is omega, and that difference omega, the detuning is this one, this difference, so simple. Eh? The detuning of the photon frequency from the difference of energies. Omega, here, it's called Rampe coupling, and it represents the strength of the field. And you see here that these two numbers here, the steady state, depends on the detuning. Of course, depends from another atomic parameter, where is the gamma, the spontaneous emission. This cannot be changed. But also depends, and this is the important thing, it depends on the strength of the field, which other In other words, means that the suggestibility of the system, it cannot be non-linear with the field, simply because the relation with the field is also exists in the denominator. I remind you again, once more, those two numbers here are directly related with this chi omega, which David Atwood was written with this and refracting index and all of this. Okay, this chi omega here, it cannot be. It gives the information that this is now the strength of the field induced non-linear effects in the refraction index. Okay, this is one example about the strong field effects on a simple two-level system. Yes?
Maybe general question. The title is high field interactive matter, and then when you try to solve the function, you use the linearity property, size equals C1 phi plus. This is a kind of linear property, where linearity works fine when the field is weak, actually.
Yes.
And then,
if the field is weak, look here. I tell you now in the next slide. All right. In the case of that the field is weak, you will see that these two numbers, when the field is weak, this and the meaning here that what is weak, this should be weak compared to the spontaneous emission rate and compared with the detuning. And the meaning of weak here means that this should be much smaller than those two factors, from the detuning and the spontaneous emission rate. Then, the dipole, which is represented, this is the real part and the complex part, it is linearly dependent from the strength of the field here. You see? And this is the proportionality factor, which does not contain any field. You see, this was the question.
But you started already from, maybe the beginning, maybe the problem is that, no, the thing is...
You mean I started here, what?
I think you're thinking that's perturbation theory that started, but it's not.
Well, I thought the idea is stroke field interaction, and then I was expecting me to begin from the linearity.
No,
stuff.
Look. This here, it is everything, it's the full law of interaction, Schrödinger equation. Here there is no any approximation. You can start making approximation by, for example, considering that the strength of this interaction here is much smaller than that. Then you can develop a perturbation theory. Okay. But if you go and solve this problem, without making any assumption about V, then you should turn to this system of equations and to these solutions, which this solution includes this non-linear dependence of the polarization. Okay? The higher the field, let's see here what happens when the field, right, when the field is weak, we have these solutions, so linear dependence with the field. But when you have very strong field, then you have a saturation, meaning that no dipole exists at all, and this number, it is equal, this C1, C2 are equal 1/2, and means that the number of atoms that you have here are equal to the numbers of the atoms that you are there. So, therefore, there is dynamic balance. Okay? about what comes in and what comes out. When you have very strong heat, this is what we call saturation. Okay? Now, one interesting thing is also what happens when you have a real FEL field, which a real FEL field has stochastic. It's stochastic in time and in frequency. In time, it is stochastic. Means that the field, if you see it in time, it looks like while a coherent field would look like that, if this time it is a selective field, an FEL field looks like this awful thing, really unpredictable, the amplitude, both in time and photon frequency. Then, when you make the main effect of the fluctuations of the FEL field, it can be shown that results only to this. Remember, this is again the polarization, representative polarization, and what happens? The fluctuation of the FEL field adds only its bandwidth at a certain level of approximation. Therefore, we have not only the spontaneous emission width, but also we have the bandwidth of the laser. Again, I skip the derivation for this. And of course, this is here in order to derive this nice analytical formula, one should make some approximations. And in order to this happen, one should use a decorrelation approximation, which somehow it's called, it represents the fact that if your field, the spikes or the fields are much faster than the time that the populations grows and decrease, then you should result to a solution like this. Now, let me go ahead now with another problem. Assume that you have a zinc photon, ionization of helium. This is a photon, and this is the helium, 1s square, and with that photon here, of course, one electron can get this photon energy ionized, or two electrons, whatever. This is photon energy, and this one is, it is the probability of occurring this event, to absorb a photon with that photon frequency. Therefore, if you start with photon frequency from here and you scan all this region, then the probability goes down, but somewhere here it hits a resonance. This one. This is what we call atomizing resonance, and you see it can be really, really large. You go ahead and you can't go here. If you tune your system here, then this means that you have no absorption at all. And no absorption at all means that the system, it is transparent. Therefore, you radiate your system above the ionization, and if you are tuned here, you do not absorb. The system does not absorb. And of course, there are also other resonances. Now, this is a weak field thing. And the Fermi-Golden rule here, of course, it holds. Sigma times the intensity. That's well known. And it's a perturbation theory. Now, what happens if we increase the strength of the field? In the beginning, now, let me explain you what is this. This is that feature here represents a weak field case, which is that one. If you scale it, if you zoom here, you will have something like this, which really reminds that one. Now, but if you start increasing your field, the strength of the field, then this shape really changes. It can be depend. This is the what means here strong. It is related with, because it is basically it is an observed, if you want, state. There is a decay width, and the strong the magnitude, and what is strong or not, it depends on the decay width of the of that state, of that observed state, if you want. So, the, increasing the intensity, you can have any shape here. This is really a very strong modification of the line shape of absorption, that one. Now, let's go ahead. Maybe here it is, let me see. Okay. Now, you have again helium. You ionize. This is one child of ionization. And of course, you have an electron with that kinetic energy here. This is the ground state, the first ionization threshold, and the second ionization threshold. Here, when you have energy here, means that you can ionize one electron. And when you have an energy here, you can two electrons can get the energy and can go away. In that channel here, the electron's kinetic energy is this one. And but if you increase your intensity, you can have also an extra channel, which from here, the system, here is the helium plus, because one electron is away. Is away, gets two electrons and can ionize also the second electron. Or you can have two photon absorption, the two electrons get at the same time the energy and they ionized, and at the same time you have three different channels. These are called sequential channels, while this one direct. I remind you, in these sequential channels, the system is double ionized by a step procedure. Synchronization, another further synchronization of helium plus, while here it's double ionization, two photon double ionization. And this is the dependence of this channel, of the probability for these channels to happen as a function of the intensity. Okay? So, really, the strength of the field really change the probabilities between among these different channels. Here we start. You start with a direct. The for low intensities, this channel is the dominant one, while for stronger intensities, for lower intensities, the direct one, this channel is a stronger one, while for higher intensities, this channel becomes the dominant one. Alright, what about the photoelectron spectrum? The same thing. You have one photon absorption, and the kinetic energy, it is this number here, and if you're looking, if you detect, try to detect it, you will find an electron about 20.1 eV. This is a 45 eV photon, while this is 24.6. Now, if you increase the intensity of your system, what you will find also another peak. Simply because we have that sequential channel, which is, you have one electron ionized from here, from the ground state, and one further electron ionized from helium plus. And this is another effect of the what is happening when you increase intensity of your field. And this is a rather irrelevant figure, which only says that the two electrons go away in a back-to-back pattern. Now, maybe I want to give a final example now of strong fields effects. I put it the same. All right. About the Zerline splitting of neon. Now, I will show that what is the Zer spectrum? Zer is again the I saw here what is exactly the Zer. Zer spectrum, I mean the Zer electron spectrum. When I ionize from the inner cell of an atomic system, an electron goes away. This is a photon electron. While after that, because I have the hole, this is filled, that hole, and I have the ejection another electron. And that electron, the second electron, is called a Zer. The question is, what is the kinetic energy of this electron? Normally, it is a Lorentzian one. Now, so I will show what happens when you have a neon under radiation, stronger radiation of 908 EVs. And then I will give an example about the role of the field of the FEL fluctuations. Therefore, the system, you start from neon, you excite, you ionize an electron, from, you ionize the neon, you get an electron from the inner cell, 1s, and this electron goes away with that, it's a photoelectron generated, and has this more kinetic energy. The field is 908 EVs, that difference here is 870 EVs, therefore we have about 48 EV photoelectron going away. But we have a hole in neon, in the inner cell, and this hole is filled. And it's filled from the outer electron. And after it is filled, we have an extra electron that is generated, which is called a Zer electron. And the difference, and that the kinetic energy of this, it is the difference between neon 2 plus and neon plus. Remember that this state is neon plus, hollow neon plus, because you got one electron from the inner cell that was ejected, while here should be neon 2 plus. And not because, except from the photoelectron, you have the Zer electron that was ejected. But now the difference is that this is a fillet, neon plus 2. And again, the Zer electron should have normally the energy between these two eigenstates of the system, the hollow neon plus and the neon 2 plus, which is 804.5 eV. Therefore, if you make a measurement, you should find your electron here. And you should find a Lorentzian spectrum, that one, that the one that is comes from the exponential decay law, the time dependence, because the time dependence of this is exponential, decay law, this will give a Lorentzian spectrum for your Zer electron. Now the question is that what is the problem is if the photon energy of the FEL is such that ionizes the neon in the beginning, excites the neon 2 plus, the final state, while the neon plus decays. So the whole process is this one. Ionize the first electron, decays another electron, while a core electron at the same time is excited. It's a resonant condition that I'm talking here. I tune my photon frequency with excited state of the neon 2+. This, I will show that, will result a very strong modification of the Zohr line, of the Lorentzian shape, simply because the field is strong. And then I will also show the effect of the fluctuation of the field. Therefore, 908 dB here, this is the resonant condition, and it represents the 1S3P excitation of the neon 2+. All right? Normally, those S spectrum should look like that. But if you make it really strong, for example, this is 10 to 5, 15 watts per centimeter square. But if you're really increasing this scheme, your field, then you will see a splitting bit of this shape. In this case, because I assume a resonant condition, that is, the detuning is zero, then these are equal in height. And this is, of course, the Zohr kinetic energy. If you measure it, you will see the splitting. And the strength, that distance here, depends on your photo, of your strength of your field. And it's called the Rabi coupling. Now, of course, I skip everything about equations, derivation, calculations, and I give an example here, a Fourier transform limited of 48.8 femtosecond pulse. You start with 1016 pulse, and this corresponds to a Rabi coupling, which is the decay, it is three times the decay time of the neon plus. I remind you that after the first photon, from the first photon absorption, the decay time of this Zohr state neon plus, hollow, it's 2.4 EVs, 2.4 femtosecond. It needs 2.4 femtosecond. And the pulse here, it is 50 femtosecond. And this here corresponds that between the during this 2.4 femtosecond that the electron requires to go down and decays, the strength of the field is such that makes oscillations, which is nothing else that it says that the electron goes until the decay, the electron goes three times this round here. Right? And this generate a splitting. If you increase the strength, again you have a larger splitting, which says that the electron during this decay it took six times, and so on. Increasing the strength, it makes that transition faster and faster and faster, and this is mirrored to the Zohr electron spectrum. Remember, the important thing here is that the Zohr electron goes away, but this transition happens to another electron. Okay? It's not the Zohr electron that goes away, but another, the core electron. And this is a clear indication about the non-somehow separability of quantum wave functions. One electron goes away and it is affected by what happens to another electron which is far away from it. Okay? And so the idea is we go all, and all of this of course depends on, and here this is again the same example with the difference now that you have detuned your system. Eh? Again, the Zohr electron spectrum changes, but with an equal height, they have an asymmetric profile, but because the system is detuned now. And this goes ahead. Now, as a final thing, I will give an example about the role of the FEL fluctuations here, which of course it's more realistic. Any FEL now has this time structure. And this time structure, of course, also, if we take the Fourier transform of this, it will also have an awful frequency structure like that. And for example, for SLS, for one keV photon energy, the bandwidth is 9 eV, and the coherence time is 0.3 femtosecond, this one. That difference, and this is time. And these represent amplitude, therefore amplitude and phase fluctuations. Amplitude has to do with the strength, with phase fluctuation, they give means that they will have different frequencies in the field, randomly distributed. And why this is a problem when you make transition? Because assume that you have, again, this transition here and here. It happened, and also assume that I have a transition initially in the ground state of mu plus here, which is you have very strong up field. This means that this transition is really strong, and the system will go there with high probability. But just after this, the system, the field, has an amplitude which is almost zero. This means that I will stay here. I have no chance to go down, especially if I'm in the femtosecond routine. So I will stay, depending on the field, and the field is random. Then I don't know what will happen. I wait until you have some intensity. Again, this random. When I have again intensity, this will go down. I have high probability to go down, and so on. This transition, therefore, affects randomly the results, and it might have the next spike to DXI, and so on. Now, in the frequency domain, similar things. In the frequency domain, remember when I have resonance conditions, I have very high probability to have the excitation or de-excitation. When I have resonant conditions, then the system can go here with a high probability, but if it happens in the next, the next photons have a different frequency, this is random, from here it then becomes off resonant, and then the probability to go down becomes small. Until, and I'm waiting other photons to have a good, somehow, resonant conditions. And then, randomly, I will go down with high probability. And this goes all the time. Therefore, all the process is really stochastic, and you have one shot, you have a final state of your system. But if you send another shot, then you will have another result. And then you send another shot, another result. All these, finally, you collect them, all these different, and finally, what you get, it is the average all of these different shots. And some other properties also are becoming, everything becomes random. And how you model this, you have two different ways. One is to get the FEL parameters, the machine parameters, and you extract the time dependence of the field. This can be done, though a bit computationally demanding. Or you get information about what is the power spectrum and the coherence time of the field. And maybe you already know that the time dependence and the frequency dependence are interrelated by a Fourier transform. So if I know the power spectrum of the coherence time, I can find this here. And if I have this, I have my sample, And how we do that anyway, these are details which are not of interest. Alright, the field in general is assumed to be Gaussian stochastic process, means that there are two quantities that fully characterize the stochastic properties, the first order correlation and the second one. And the second one, of course, the first order gives information about the power spectrum, while the second one gives information about the photon patching of photons, meaning that depending on this function, it gives information whether the photons are coming together or not, or one after the other, whatever. Markovian, the process is Markovian, meaning that any transition, it depends not only in the power, not in the past history, what happened a long time ago, but only what is at that time of the transition. What is the situation? And also it's a codic, which after some time will lose information about the initial time of the system. All right, you put into account all this, and what do we have? The black one is a deterministic pulse. It's a result which, if we use a pulse which is Fourier transform limited, a nice one. And that red one, it is if we use a stochastic pulse with some degree of stochasticity. The pulse, here is this one, one shot, and this is represents the average of 500 shots. Okay? That one. If you decrease stochasticity here, then you have this one, you decrease stochasticity, you decrease stochasticity, and of course if you decrease, this becomes really deterministic, the pulse, and thus the two spectrums should somehow coincide. Okay? And that is the thing. Now, I think this is almost the end. I only want to, there was one or two things that was interesting to me to demonstrate as a strong field effects. I only said one thing to this. The fact, all these calculations here and all assumptions we have done, we assumed a classical representation of the field, meaning that when we do the calculations, ET, we write the field like this. Here, therefore the field is a wave. But of course you know that actually the field is a quantum mechanical object. And the fact that this works, that representation, it's a strong field effect. Simply because the number of the photons are really large, but there is some peculiarity here. It is not only, if you want, this representation here corresponds to a quantum mechanical field which not only has a large number of photons, but it is a linear combination of photon states, but that linear combination of photon states makes Heisenberg relation about frequency time to take the minimum volume. And this is what we call coherent states. If you had any experience about oscillators, quantum mechanical oscillators, coherent states are those functions, a solution, a linear combination of the solution of oscillators, that they give delta omega times delta t the minimum value. So if you take that coherent state into account, and you take the value, you increase the value of that characterizes this linear combination, then not only you have high large number of photons, then you will get the statistical properties of your quantum mechanical field, which is very close to the classical one. And that is why we can work in strong, in this case, with the classical representation of the field. Okay. I think here I finish. So if you don't have questions,
last time Professor David Akut presented, showed us a curve of Bose electron fluorescent and photoelectron emission processes versus atomic number. So he said that if you go for lower Z elements,
yes,
the Auger process dominates.
Ah, it is, yes. Neon, that's a good point. I chose neon. Okay, the dominant process, the ratio between fluorescence and Auger goes with Z in the fourth power. So for neon, the dominant process, here for example, yes, I remember what you mean, which figure you use. The fluorescence, it is 54 times smaller than the Auger decay, if this is what you that one. Here, there is a fluorescence to neon plus, the neon plus hollow can radiate one large photon and goes to neon plus full one, fillet cells. And can at the same time, of course, it can decay with the Z process. That process here is 55 times smaller than this one, so I ignore. But this scheme also, the fluorescence also, can be modified because of strong fields. Eh? Okay, is this was the question or not?
Yeah, but I was wondering why it strongly depended on Z, the nuclear charge. If I want to go and take my sample to somewhere, and if I don't know which technique to use, was it photoelectron or Auger electron, the first thing that comes to my mind is to go for the Z. If my element, my sample has low Z, I go for Auger. If it is high Z, I'll go for photoelectron.
It is easy. First of all, almost always you will have a Auger case. But whether you have a Auger case depends where you're sitting in energy. It is only a matter of where you go in an energy difference between the final state and the initial state. John?
Yeah, no, I think the main point is that you use a technique like Auger electron spectroscopy or X-ray fluorescence. If you use low Z, the X-ray fluorescence yield is very, very low. But the Auger electron yield is high. And that's because the Auger rate depends on Z to the power of 4. Yeah? So for example, our 1 over Z to the power of 4. So that's the reason why it's not photoelectron, which non-process under, it's photo generation, it's fluorescence. Light. So the same process which is calculated here showing the Auger electron with the Rabi flopping and the splitting, you can also see in the fluorescence.
Indeed.
The problem is that fluorescence is 55 times weaker than Auger electron emission. So you would still use Auger electron emission. So it's completely consistent with what Dave Atwood said the other day. Yeah? Auger, in this particular case.
If you remember, David Atwood had a graph. I put it this way. This is Z, and this is Auger process and fluorescence. The Auger process was like that, while the fluorescence was like that. After some Z, the fluorescence had higher rate, much higher rate than the Auger one. For low Z, the Auger processes are dominating. meaning that any atom that you collect comes most probably from other processes. This does not mean, of course, there are not atoms that they have, you will find neon plus coming from fluorescence, but there are all very few. I'm also doing the German.
In fact, I think it's connected with this, that photo excitation is more probably if the distance between and the energy of the transition is very high, yes?
No, because you can have really high energies, but then depend also on your atomic system. It's not only the photon energy that, or the strength that determines this, but also what is the atomic system that you have there. For neon, again, the Z is such that the observed process, the transition matrix elements between initial and final states are giving much larger values between this and the transition matrix element that are given between for fluorescence quantities. This changes with Z.
I'm going back to whether you look at the photoelectron, that depends on the photoionization cross section. So obviously in xeno 90 eV it's very high photoelectron cross section, so you get you generate a lot of photoelectrons. But as you go to much higher photon energies for a fixed Z, photoionization cross section is dropping. But not necessarily the OJ. It depends on the your matrix elements that you have in it. Or whichever process you're looking at, whether it's an OJ process, whether it's fluorescence, or whether it's photoionization. But in that particular case, I don't know if it was clear to people, it's the same pulse which ionizes in the first step. Yeah? Exactly the same pulse, except you tune it to the 1s to 3p and the neon 2 plus. That's enough energy to ionize neutral neon by ejecting the core electron, leaving a hole in the 1s state. That neon plus, what happens there is one electron fills that hole and another electron is ejected. Now two electrons have gone from the neon, and neon 2 plus is what's left. And now the field is resonant with the neon 2 plus. And it's so strong, it optically pumps up, but then it optically pumps down. So stimulated absorption, stimulated emission, stimulated absorption, stimulated emission. That's rapid flow.
So in total are three electrons that participate.
But you can only do that with an FEL.
Now just two quick questions. Is the yield time up to a single shot at an FEL? For it to be able to characterize each pulse.
So, what?
Would the electron yield be high enough to be able to record it?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, the first step signal, you mean?
As the Auger signal is detected, if the profile...
The final signal will depend how high, what is the rate of the first step.
Yeah.
How fast you ionize, what is the cross-section for ionizing the neon from 1s. And this is the highest that you can find. I mean, of course there is ionization from valence cells, but those are 10 times or 100 times less. So this is the highest probability.
And process. Then is the Auger spectrum, is that unique?
Yes.
It is unique when you are not in resonance with something.
But for the stochastic case.
It is again will be Lorentzian, but because of the stochastic fluctuation, again will be broadened.
And is it that broadening of stars? Like if you were to get a single shot spectrum, would you be able to?
Look, the Lorentzian say it is an atomic parameter. It's because the spontaneous emission, if you want, whatever it is this. It is exponentially decaying low. The broadening and all any other effects, it becomes of the field, because of the field. Okay,
Yeah.
It's the field that that's this one. Okay. I'm doing also the chairman session. Thanks a lot for having me today.